Hello, everyone. Putin had better be careful because he had just complained that no one will help Russia. And I would like to point this out to his allies, Iran, Syria, North Korea, China. This dude does not appreciate you. This, despite the fact that he had literally just signed a major agreement with North Korea, promising that they would help each other in case of an open conflict. And despite the fact that China, North Korea, and Iran have all been supplying either components necessary for military manufacturing or the actual weapons such as missiles and Iran's Shahed drones. Moreover, I want to point everybody toward this report. So this goes back to my assertion that sanctions do not work against people like Russia, because there are still plenty of others who are not affected by the same sanctions or to the same extent who will support Russia. So this particular one is talking about weapons manufacturing, and the big mystery was, where are the semiconductors coming from? Because that was one thing that Russia routinely got from abroad. And the answer is from the same places it's been getting them from, through Belarus. Oh, that was difficult to figure out. I know that I say this a lot during these reports when I say, look at the map, look at the map, look what is there, look what can be done. Maps are useful. They tell a story. And this is a story of why sanctions are not working. Because as long as Belarus is still Russia's allies and it is not subject to the same sanctions, because technically speaking, it's not involved in the direct conflict with Ukraine, it has the ability to siphon what Russia needs from Europe. It's really that simple. Going back to that, if you're going to punish Russia's allies for supporting Russia's invasion of Ukraine, you gotta figure out a better way to do this. So this is about, you know, China's tech support for Russia during Ukraine. Okay, you're gonna call it a major mistake, and we've been asking this question for a while. Do you really think China gives a shit that you called it a major mistake? What are you gonna do? Once again, consider where China is positioned economically and politically. And you tell me what is required to really send the message to China. What's in it for them? Why should they stop helping Russia? And remember, again, we talked about this many times, Russia is sort of right now a test, a dress rehearsal for China, because China wants to know, will Russia in fact get away with invasion of Ukraine, because it's got its own territorial skeletons in its own closet. We all know what I'm talking about. So just giving China not even a particularly strong slap on the wrist by saying, oh, it was a mistake to support Russia, is not going to do a damn thing. Here's another thing. So we know that Russia repeatedly created troll mills, repeatedly attempted to infiltrate information systems of various countries, including the EU, the UK, and the US, Ukraine. We know all that. We know there's been numerous cyber attacks, etc., etc. So this is just the latest in the long line of cyber crimes. In this particular case, we have a person who was intending to destroy Kyiv computer systems. This person, unfortunately, remains at large. Now, there's now charges and there's a bounty on his head, a substantial bounty. So I'm kind of hoping that people will appreciate $10 million and turn him in. But this guy has been operating for 2 years now, and we are only just trying to catch him? Really? Meanwhile, Evan Gershevich is on trial, of course, closed-door trial in Yekaterinburg, 15 months after his arrest. That's your citizens, guys. And he's not the only one. He's not the only one who has been arrested. He's not the only one who is in deadly danger. And there's been some killed, too. Has anything been done about it? As we know, he was arrested on espionage charges. Both his employer and the U.S. government deny this. And remember, Russia is like that. You know, they basically can point at anybody and say, yep, you're a spy. A carelessly dropped word, a statement, a phone call, a note, literally anything can land you in Russian prison, which is why I don't understand why more countries haven't closed their embassies there and yanked their personnel, because it is not safe there from them. While it is traditionally expected to respect the embassy territory, because in the international law, the embassy of the country is the territory of this country. Do you really think those gates are going to hold up against a Russian mob if Putin were to snap his little fingers and say, go get him? Doubt it. And as part of, again, Ukraine's interaction with the EU, we are expecting a security agreement with Zelensky, pledging to keep delivering weapons to Ukraine as well as military training. So that's good news. I want to wrap up with two personal interest stories. One is about an American blogger, Russian Texas Bentley, who was a huge fan of Russia and Russia's invasion of Ukraine. Here he is shown with the Russian tanks in the background. He was found dead in eastern Ukraine. He was kidnapped by Russian 5th Tank Battalion soldiers, raped and shot. This is the guy who supported Russia. Remember this. Food for thought. A very different story. This is about yet another small village in the border region of Ukraine where people are hanging on for dear life because they do not want to leave their home. The village of Dalina that has been basically all but destroyed shortly after the war began. It was a tiny village, 500 residents, until the Russians came, and now it's basically in the single digits. With these border regions, the situation being as unstable as it is, because the aid to Ukraine has been inconsistent, people had to evacuate and return multiple times. So at this point, they're not sure what's worse, because both staying and going carries its own risks. This is somebody's home. This is Ukraine.